हेलो फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज़ डॉक्टर फॉरम जोशी फ्रॉम जी सेट अगेन, एंड आई एम विथ द सेकेंड चैप्टर, सेकेंड यूनिट ऑफ द न्यू रिवाइज सिलेबस ऑफ फिजिक्स 2110011. द सेकेंड यूनिट इज़ मैग्नेटिक मटीरियल्स. बट फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, टुडे इज़ द फ्रेंडशिप डे, सो हैप्पी फ्रेंडशिप डे टू ऑल ऑफ यू, राइट? एन्जॉय. ओके, वी विल स्टार्ट अवर सिलेबस. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, वी विल जस्ट रिव्यू दैट वॉट आर द टॉपिक्स दैट वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी इन दिस पर्टिकुलर चैप्टर. वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी सेवरल डेफिनेशंस विच आर द बेसिक्स ऑफ द मैग्नेटिज्म कंटेनिंग मैग्नेटिक मोमेंट, मैग्नेटिक डायपोल, मैग्नेटिक फील्ड स्ट्रेंथ, मैग्नेटिक फ्लक्स डेंसिटी, इंटेंसिटी ऑफ मैग्नेटाइजेशन. वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी द मैग्नेटिक डायपोल मोमेंट अगेन फ्रॉम डिफरेंट पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू. देन मैग्नेटिक फील्ड इंटेंसिटी, मैग्नेटिक परमीएबिलिटी, मैग्नेटिक ससेप्टिबिलिटी, एंड मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंटली बोर मैग्नेटॉन, विच इज़ अ यूनिट ऑफ मैग्नेटिक फील्ड. We are going to also classify the magnetic materials on the basis of magnetic moment. There are major five types of magnetic materials. We are going to study the difference between soft and hard magnetic materials and their applications, ferrites, antiferromagnetic materials, and magnetic recording and readout storage of magnetic data. That means we are going to study a lot of things about magnetism in this particular chapter. Okay, we will start with what is the origin of the magnetism in materials. Why do material behave as a permanent or temporary magnet, or which are the materials, or why the materials do not behave as a magnetic material, or say that material do not possess the magnetic property, they do not exhibit the magnetic properties. The origin is a moving electric charge. As you know, a moving electric charge is always, that always produces a current, and when current goes on, then there is a magnetic field produced. Magnetic dipole is created due to the moving field charge, moving electric charge. Macroscopically this is also true, also microscopically this is true. Nuclear spin, say origin of magnetism, one can say that in an atom there are two or three types of motion. First, nuclear spin, second, spin of electrons, and third, the orbital motion of electrons. Due to nuclear spin, it is a very very weak effect, and due to the spin of the electrons, where unpaired electrons mobilize themselves, then there is a net magnetic moment which is created, and that is the origin of any type of magnetism in the material. So magnetic moment resultant from the spin of a single unpaired electron, that is the Bohr magneton. We will study it in detail when we reach at the end of the definitions. Okay, this is the first topic that we are going to study, that is magnetic materials and non-magnetic materials. Which are the materials which behave as magnetic, which behave as magnet in the presence of a magnetic field, then they are called magnetic materials. Actually, they are magnetized by the application of the external magnetic field. And secondary, non-magnetic materials, they are not magnetized due to the application of the external magnetic field. You can see here in the diagram, there is a in the presence of the magnet, the bottom is the magnet. In the presence of the magnet, the upper one, the figure A, that shows that their dipole moments are aligned in a particular way. You can say that there is a magnetic layer. And in another one, there is a non-magnetic layer. Under the effect of the magnetic field, you can say that they are opposing the external magnetic field. So those are the non-magnetic materials. Now here is a magnetic dipole. A magnetic dipole, it is actually made up of north and south pole, and the lines of magnetic field, they are passing from north to south in the outer surroundings of the magnet, and inside the magnet it is going from south to north. All of you know this is the very basic things. And one more thing, magnetic field lines, they are actually closed loops. So a magnetic dipole is the limit of either a closed loop of electric current or a pair of poles, as the dimension of the source are reduced to zero, right? So you can see in the lowermost diagram, magnetic, that proves that magnetic monopole does not exist. At any case, if you break a magnet, then also the two pieces of the magnet, they behave as a single and independent magnet. There is no magnetic monopole. As per in case of electricity, always electric dipole, electric monopole exists, right? While magnetic monopole does not exist. The second definition is magnetic moment. You can see here that it can be considered as it is to be a vector quantity. Of course, M is defined as the multiplication of current and the surface area. Current loop, say it is it can be measured with respect to the surface area perpendicular, and the right hand rule applies. The unit is Weber, right? You can see here in the diagram that the directional quantity, that is mu, that is the magnetic moment of any of the current. Okay, next one, magnetic field strength. It is a mathematical description of magnetic influence of electric currents and magnetic materials. It is the vector quantity again, and it is a magnetic field having ability to exert a force which is in the form of a magnetic field, and this force is exerted on electric charges. You can see here H is equal to B0 upon mu 0, or it is B0 divided by mu 0 minus M. The unit is ampere per meter. It is also defined as the ratio of magnetic flux density to the magnetic permeability. Okay, what is the magnetic permeability that we are going to study next? The magnetic flux density is defined as the strength of the magnetic field at a particular point, and it is expressed by the force per unit length. So B is equal to mu 0 H. In the case of if magnetization is present, then B is equal to mu 0 H plus M. And what is the unit? It is again ampere per meter, or specifically it is known as Tesla. And you know that Tesla is the unit of magnetic flux density. That's why that is actually an MKS unit, because it is expressed as ampere per meter. What is the CGS unit? The CGS unit is Gauss. And what is the conversion? You may have studied 1 Tesla is equal to 10 raised to minus 4 Gauss. Okay, 10 raised to 4 Gauss. Intensity of magnetization. It is the extent or degree up to which the material can be magnetized. It is the strength of the external magnetic field which can penetrate through the material to magnetize it. So the internal property of the given material, that is the intensity of magnetization. It is defined as the net magnetic dipole moment per unit volume in that particular region. So it is proportional to the external magnetic field, as well as it is the internal property. So magnetization, so intensity of magnetization, the unit is Tesla or Weber per meter square. The magnetic susceptibility, again it is a quantitative measure to the extent, up to what extent the material can be magnetized. So chi, generally it is denoted as the Greek symbol chi. Chi is the ratio of H and M. Okay, the next one, magnetic permeability. It is the ratio of amount of magnetic density B to the applied external magnetic field H, that is mu is equal to B by H. It is the measure of the ability of a substance to sustain a magnetic field equal to the ratio between magnetic flux density and the magnetic strength. See, there are two properties. Magnetic susceptibility is the measure up to which extent it can be magnetized. And the second one, the magnetic permeability, it shows the ability of the substance to sustain the magnetic field. Next one, the relation between magnetic parameters. These two are the magnetic parameters which depend upon, of course, external magnetic field. And second, they are the internal properties of the material. So mu R, that is the relative permeability, is equal to 1 plus chi. That is the relation. And the relative permeability mu r can be also defined as the absolute permeability divided by the permeability of the space, that is mu r is equal to mu upon mu 0. Now the most important unit, the most important quantity in the magnetism, the magnetic moment of an atomic particle is represented by a unit ampere into meter square. So the value of this one Bohr magneton is eh upon 4 pi m, and if I substitute the value for e, that is 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulomb, h 6.626 into 10 raised to minus 34 joule into second, and 4 pi, pi is 3.14, and mass of an electron is 9.1 into 10 raised to minus 31 kg. So if I substitute this value, if I multiply those things and if I divide it with the number of 4 pi m, then I will get 9.27 into 10 raised to minus 24 ampere into meter square. This is the unit of magnetic field. Generally, very small magnetic fields are measured in Bohr magneton. And what are the small magnetic fields? These are the magnetic field which are say emitted by the magnetic field signals which are emitted by human body, say our brain or our heart. When it is pumping, it creates electromagnetic signals, and these signals, they can be measured. They cannot be measured in Tesla, they even cannot be measured in Gauss, but they can be measured in this type of Bohr magneton. Very weak magnetic signals are there from our brain, and this this type of signal mapping can be done through this type of very small unit. So this is the basic unit of magnetization. Next one. Now, on the basis of the magnetic moment possessed by the material, we can classify the materials in basically two types of material. One, those who possess magnetic moment, or say dipole moments, and those who do not possess the dipole moments. First two, they are diamagnetic materials and paramagnetic materials. And another three, they are ferromagnetic, antiferromagnetic, ferrimagnetic materials. And here I would like to add that this antiferromagnetic and ferrimagnetic material, they are the ferrimagnetic material, they are the subset of antiferromagnetic materials, right? So first two materials, or say all the five materials, how they behave under the effect of external magnetic field, that will decide the type of the magnetic field. Right. So first of all, we will take we can see the dipole moments of the magnetic properties, or say magnetic properties, the dipole moments of different types of magnetic material. You can see magnetic materials with unpaired electrons, and another one, non-magnetic or diamagnetic material. Those are the in those materials, the electrons are paired. So in that case, we don't need to see any type of dipole moment orientation. But you can see in paramagnetic material, the dipole moments are randomly oriented. I should say the magnetic dipole moments are randomly oriented. You must be knowing the domain theory. In any of the material, the magnetic dipoles, they possess when the material possesses a permanent magnetic dipole moment, they are aligned in random way. In paramagnetic materials, they are aligned in the random way, and when the external magnetic field is applied, they will align themselves in a particular way. Now, ferromagnetic materials, when external magnetic field is applied, you can see all of them are aligned, all of the magnetic dipoles are aligned in a particular direction. Antiferromagnetic, you can see that the magnetic field direction, they are aligned in, half of them are aligned in the magnetic field direction, and half of them are aligned in a different direction, which is opposite to that. So they are antiferromagnetic materials. Second one, or say the last one, that is ferrimagnetic material, in them, if you can observe the direction of the arrows, they are aligned opposite to each other, of course, but if you can see the magnitude, they are aligned opposite to each other, but they are not equal in magnitude. If you have observed the direction in antiferromagnetic material, you would see that the magnitude and the direction, the magnitudes of the adjacent arrows, they are the same, but in ferrimagnetic material, the magnitudes are opposite and they are not equal, right? So this is a different type of ferrimagnetic material, and when they were discovered, they have opened a very vast area of applications in the magnetic materials. We will take first the diamagnetic materials. You can see here, basically they create a magnetic field in opposite to an externally applied magnetic field. That means they oppose the effect of the external magnetic field. Here you can say, here you can see in the figure that the B, that is external magnetic field, is applied in the upwards direction, but inside the material there is an opposing magnetic field is created because the electrons are paired. It is a quantum mechanical effect that occurs in all materials, but whether it is prominently displayed or not, that will depend upon the material itself. And it is the only contribution to the magnetism the material is called a diamagnet. All of the materials, they are diamagnetic material up to a certain extent. If it is prominent, then it is called a diamagnet. So diamagnets were first discovered by Sebald Justinus Brugmans. He observed the material that it is opposing, it is strongly opposing the external magnetic field. And the word diamagnetic or diamagnetism was given after 40 years of this discovery. Up to a greater or lesser degree, it is a property of all materials, as I told you, and it always makes a weak contribution to the material's response to external magnetic field. For materials, they show some other form of magnetism, such as paramagnetism, ferro or antiferromagnetism, the diamagnetic contribution becomes negligible. What are the properties? The properties are, they do not have a permanent dipole moment. So magnetic effects are very weak and so often masked by other kind of magnetism. They repel the magnetic lines of force. The magnetization becomes zero on removal of the external magnetic field. What are the other properties? The susceptibility, chi is equal to H by M. So susceptibility of a diamagnetic material is negative because they are not magnetized. It is independent of the temperature and external field. What are the examples? Copper, gold, mercury, etc. are the examples of pure diamagnetic materials. They exhibit a pure diamagnetic effect, right? What are the paramagnetic materials? Paramagnetism, it is a form of magnetism.